Hi, I'm the History Guy. I have a degree in history and I love history. And if you love history too, this is the channel for you. George Gordon Byron was one of the most famous poets in history. Better known as Lord Byron, he was a leader in the Romanticism movement of the late 18th and early 19th century, famous for works like Don Juan and the poem She Walks in Beauty. But it is perhaps indicative of the Romanticists' rejection of Western traditions like rationalism, moral absolutes, and agreed-upon social values that Lord Byron was as well known in his lifetime for his excesses as his poetry. Things like numerous love affairs with both men and women, many of whom were married, or running up huge gambling debts, or an obsession with drink and drugs. But it was this unruly streak that ironically had a surprising impact on the most rational of professions. Computer programming. It all has to do with a remarkable but underappreciated mathematician and involves some of the most famous people of the Victorian era. It is history that deserves to be remembered. George Gordon Byron was born in 1788. If he was going to grow up to be a psychopath, he came upon it honestly. His mother, Catherine Gordon, was given to bouts of melancholy and mood swings and was described as a woman without judgment or self-command. His father, an abusive, profligate drunkard, was a British army officer who went by the name Mad Jack and who abandoned his wife and son after spending all her money, dying likely of an overdose of opium when Byron was just 3 years old. He inherited his title, Baron Byron of Rochdale, at the age of 10 upon the death of his great uncle, but the estate had little value. In 1811, he published the narrative poem Child Harold's Pilgrimage to wide acclaim that made him famous overnight. It was then, trying to escape from growing debts and rumors about his sexual escapades, that he married Annabel Milbank, a beautiful, remarkably intelligent, and religious heiress, who apparently married Lord Byron in the hopes that she could set him on a straight moral path. In that she failed. Owing to his infidelity and erratic behavior, they separated just a month after the birth of their daughter, Lord Byron's only legitimate child, Augusta, affectionately called Ada. After their separation, Byron left England, never to return. Ada never met her father. They had no relationship. But he affected her in a unique way. Afraid that Ada would inherit her father's insanity, Lady Byron saw to it that Ada received tutoring in mathematics and music as disciplines to counter dangerous poetic tendencies, including tutoring by the famous mathematician Augustus De Morgan. In an era when women were certainly not widely encouraged to participate in intellectual pursuits, she became a mathematician. She married a baron in 1835 who was eventually made the Earl of Lovelace, making her the Countess of Lovelace. They had three children. High society in London in the 19th century was full of people pursuing science and mathematics. Included in her circle, Ada made friends and corresponded with some of the finest scientific minds of the era. Michael Faraday, Charles Wheatstone, Sir David Brewster, as well as author Charles Dickens. But the connection that would most impact her future was with mathematician and mechanical engineer Charles Babbage. Born in 1791, Charles Babbage was a gifted mathematician with a vision for applying mathematical principles to modern problems. He had his hands in many projects and ideas, from insurance actuarial tables to, notably, impacting industry through an analysis of division of labor. But Babbage's most famous contribution came from an interest in improving mathematical tables, critical for navigation, science, and engineering. Computed by hand, the tables were subject to error. Such math could be more accurately done, he argued, by a computational machine, which he called the difference engine, and which he later refined in a second model that he called the analytical engine. A difference engine is an automatic mechanical calculator used to tabulate polynomial functions. In short, it is a hand-cranked mechanical computer. Having met Babbage through a friend, Ava Lovelace became fascinated with his machine. Her largest contribution came in 1843. Babbage had given a lecture on his analytical engine in Turin, Italy. An Italian engineer had transcribed the lecture and published it in French. Realizing the lecture could help to spur interest in the project, Babbage's supporter, Charles Wheatstone, commissioned Ava to translate the article into English and to add notes. The notes ended up being longer than the paper and offered a clear understanding of the operation and potential of the machine. In the notes, she included a clear description of how Babbage's invention could be used to compute so-called Bernoulli numbers, a sequence of rational numbers which occur frequently in number theory. The implication was enormous. Her description is considered the first published algorithm ever specifically tailored for implementation on a computer. If Charles Babbage had invented the first mechanical computer, Ada Lovelace had written the first computer program. Perhaps even more importantly, she saw something that even Babbage did not. She realized that Babbage's machine could calculate beyond numbers and could theoretically solve problems of any complexity. For example, she theorized, if the fundamental relations of pitched sounds in the science of harmony and of musical composition were susceptible of such expression and adaptations, the engine might compose elaborate and scientific pieces of music of any degree of complexity or extent. Thus, she anticipated the implications of modern computing 100 years before they were realized. There is some controversy about whether she was actually the originator of the first computer program, or whether she merely derived the idea from Babbage's previous work. But her supporters note that Babbage never produced anything as sophisticated, or as clean, as Ada's computation of the Bernoulli numbers. But the point is largely moot. Babbage's machine was never completed in his time, and her program was never used. But those who studied the field of the history of the computer acknowledge that she seems to have been the first to conceive of the use of the computer beyond numerical calculations. Truly a visionary idea that earns her a unique and often forgotten place in history. Although she wrote her program long before anybody conceived of computer languages, when in the 1970s the United States Department of Defense decided to create a computer programming language to supersede the more than 450 computer programming languages that the DoD had been using, they named it after her. Called ADA, it is an international standard, still in use today. Despite her mother's efforts to protect her from her father's insanity, she emulated him in some important ways. For example, like her father, Lord Byron, she was addicted to gambling, and even wrote mathematical models that were supposed to help you be successful at gambling. They failed. Like her father, she died deeply in debt, at the age of 36, ironically the same age at which her father died, in November of 1852 of uterine cancer. Charles Dickens himself read to her from one of his novels on her deathbed. To her mother's consternation, she was buried at her request next to her father in the family tomb in Nottinghamshire. Her prophetic predictions about the potential of personal computers were largely lost until they were found and republished in 1953, and it was there, on the verge of the personal computing revolution, that a voice from the past led us into a bold new future. All because her mother did not want her to be a poet, like her dad. But they both dealt in words that changed the world. As a stanza from his poem Don Juan says, words are things, and a drop of ink dropped like dew on a thought produces that which makes thousands, perhaps millions, think. I'm the History Guy, and I hope you enjoyed this episode of my series, 5 Minutes of History, short snippets of forgotten history, 5 to 10 minutes long. And if you did enjoy, please go ahead and click that thumbs up button that is there on your left. If you have any questions or comments, or would like to suggest other topics for the History Guy, go ahead and write those in the comment section and I will be happy to respond. And if you'd like 5 minutes more of forgotten history, all you need to do is subscribe.